And now is the time for our first session, and I get the pleasure to call Mr. Chairman of the first session, Dr. Ibrahim Al-Hifdi, Dr. Khalid Sidi. Dr. Ibrahim Al-Hifdi is my second father-in-law, that he is a very known senior figures of neonatology, the leaders of many postgraduate programs, residency or neonatology fellowship in the north and the side part. Dr. Khalid Sidi is a consultant neonatologist in Medina Menawara Maternity Hospital. Welcome and the session for you.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله على بركة الله نبدأ الجلسة الأولى من هذا المؤتمر المبارك قبل البدء أتقدم بجزيل الشكر والعرفان لأخواننا زملائنا الذين عملوا بجد وأخلاص بذلوا الكثير لإنجاح هذا المؤتمر كالعادة على رأسهم الدكتور سعد الصاعدي الدكتور عبد الحكيم قطان دكتورة جبارة ودكتور النمري وجميع الأخوان الزملاء المشاركين في اللجان المختلفة. First speaker, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Hansen. He is a well-known figure in the field of neonatology. He has a very long CV and he is currently a professor of pediatrics and neonatology at the University of Oslo and the director of clinical ethics at Oslo University Hospital. He has a very great and extended experience in the field of neonatology and pediatrics. And he will talk to us today about management in the newborn, management of jaundice in the newborn infant, combining science and practicalities. Professor Hansen.
So can you guys start this thing or? Well, while we wait for the picture to come up, I would like to thank you for the kind invitation, and particularly to the organizing committee and the society for inviting me here. This is my first visit to Saudi Arabia, and I'm very much appreciative of the warm hospitality and very impressed with this beautiful venue. I hope my Norwegian-tainted English is understandable to you. And this morning I will be talking to you about jaundice in the newborn from two slightly different perspectives. So we will start to talk about management and see how the science of neonatal jaundice can be translated into practicalities. So jaundice is the most common clinical event in newborn infants. Now, when you start to consider incidence, how common is this phenomenon, then you need to question your methods of ascertainment. Do you decide that an infant is jaundiced by visual inspection only? Well, that is fraught with danger. When I teach my medical students on rounds and illustrate to them how difficult it is to recognize jaundice. In our NICU, we can pull the curtains over so it becomes pretty dusky or dark in the room. So the first thing I do is to pull the curtain over and ask them, is this baby jaundiced or not? Well, hard to tell. Then I pull the curtain back and let the sunlight in. So if you judge your incidence of jaundice based on what your eye can see, those numbers are not going to be very trustworthy. But we can get more objective by measuring jaundice in the skin by transcutaneous measurement. And obviously, the gold standard, if we can call anything a gold standard in neonatal jaundice, is serum measurements. But even there, our lab methods are not very reliable. The other thing that our incidence numbers would depend on is ethnicity. So East Asians, babies, they tend to have a higher bilirubin level than Caucasians like myself. And an African infant, I typically tell my students, if an African infant is significantly jaundiced, yes?
We need to change the computer for the...
We're talking about how incidence varies with ethnic groups, and I typically tell my medical students, if an African infant is noticeably jaundiced, then you need to think seriously about what the background is, because that is rather unusual. Geography matters. If an infant is born in Mexico City, which is 3,000 meters above sea level, the likelihood that that infant becomes jaundiced is greater than if an infant is born in Oslo, where I come from, which is at sea level. Genetics matter, and that's a topic for a whole talk in itself, so I'll just skip quickly. Feeding patterns matter. So babies who are entirely breastfed have a greater incidence of jaundice than babies who are formula fed. Now, the mechanism behind jaundice in babies are twofold. The first thing is that babies in the first few days of life produce about twice as much bilirubin per kilo of body weight as most of us sitting in this auditorium. And we know that bilirubin is produced from heme, which is found in hemoglobin, and, for instance, cytochromes and certain other molecules as well. So after birth, the infant no longer needs the fetal hemoglobin and red cells, and assuming that the baby doesn't have a hemoglobinopathy, those cells are broken down and heme is released. Now, bilirubin production gets increased further if there is an added hemolysis going on, as would be the case in ABO or rhesus incompatibility or G6D deficiency or other hemolytic anemias. The thing that most of us are aware of also is that when blood is sequestered in some way, be that in hematomas or fractures or intraventricular hemorrhages, that sequestered blood also becomes a source of increased bilirubin production. So this is what a schematic it looks like in the process going from heme to bilirubin. So we start with heme. We have the enzyme heme oxygenase. And this is the only known process in the body that releases carbon monoxide. And also it saves iron. Biliverdin is only an intermediate product, which through biliverdin reductase is converted to bilirubin, which is a yellowish-orangey compound. And the molecule, as it mostly occurs in our bodies, is in the so-called ZZ conformation, which, if you were to project it in a three-dimensional structure, has a ridge tile shape. And I borrow this slide from my now past friend, Tony McDonough. He passed away a few years ago. He lived in San Francisco, and he liked to liken the shape of the molecule with the classical houses, or roofs of the classical houses in San Francisco. So if we look at the entire process and we start here, and I am trying in vain to make my pointer work, but it won't do it. So you'll just have to imagine it from my words that you get bilirubin produced, it's released into the serum, where most of it immediately is bound to albumin, 99%+, but a tiny, tiny fraction, less than 1%, is unbound or so-called free bilirubin, and that is an important bilirubin form to consider, because there are two ways that the body can equilibrate this free bilirubin. And in fetal life, it's good for you because that unbound bilirubin can cross the placental barrier from the baby into the mom, and then the mom excretes it for the baby. So that's a good thing. Once you're born, this free bilirubin molecule becomes a potential problem because the ZZ conformation of bilirubin is fat or lipid soluble and can cross the blood-brain barrier and get into the brain, where in very unfortunate circumstances, it can cause a severe form of brain damage known as kernicterus. Now, mostly the bilirubin albumin complex, when it circulates in the blood at some point in time, is going to get through the liver circulation, where once it gets to the hepatocytes, bilirubin is internalized and in the liver cells bound to ligandin. It's conjugated by UDPGTN and excreted as conjugated bilirubin. And mostly that is excreted in the bowel contents with feces. But a small proportion of it, and particularly if the baby is not being fed for some reason, the baby could be critically ill, some of that bilirubin gets reabsorbed and goes back into the circulation. That's known as entero, from bowel, hepatic to liver, so from bowel to liver, enterohepatic circulation. And in some babies, that can also be an important contributor to persistent jaundice. Now, when medical students are taught, they are often taught about the phenomenon of physiologic versus pathologic jaundice as if that were of great importance. And indeed, it is of importance, theoretically, but it matters not one hoot when you're looking at a jaundiced baby. And I will illustrate that by showing this picture of the second tallest mountain in Norway, known as Glittertind, and people do discuss, is it really the tallest? But because if, like the tiny, tiny person you see on the glacier there, you get to the top of the glacier, it's actually taller than the tallest mountain in Norway, which doesn't have a glacier on top of it. So measuring total bilirubin is like measuring the height of this mountain. So we'll assume that this tiny person walking to the top of the glacier is a Saudi Arabian neonatologist currently visiting Norway. And he has one of those fancy new cell phones that can also give you altitude above sea level. So he or she, as the case might be, gets up there, and that's where he or she stands and measure altitude. So this is altitude. That's your total serum bilirubin. However, if the person were to climb down and stand on the summit of the rock, that would be the physiology. That's the rock. That's rock solid. That underlies any kind of bilirubin measurement that you do. Of course, the height of the glacier, that's the pathology. But when you are standing on top of the mountain, you can have no clue how many of those meters or feet that show up on your cell phone are actually rock and how much is glacier. So that illustrates pathology and physiology are theoretical concepts, but they're not very useful when you're looking at a jaundiced baby. Neonatal jaundice is transient because hemolysis, as we know, goes away, and the concentration of ligandin and the conjugating enzyme increase after birth. So in clinical practice, typically babies become visibly jaundiced sometime around the second to fourth day of life. So if jaundice actually is visible on the first day of life, and if our eyes can see it in good light, you are somewhere around 5 to 6 milligrams per deciliter, or about 85 to 100 micromoles per liter. Then you should sit up and take notice, because that is unusual. You need to look at that baby carefully and consider, in light of history, family history, or other history factors, whether or not you need to work that baby up for an underlying cause of the jaundice. So visible jaundice, first day of life, remarkable. If jaundice appears after the fourth day of life, that is also somewhat unusual. It's not quite as notable as on the first day of life, but certainly could suggest that this baby may have problems with hepatic processing and excretion. So you may want to consider things like breast milk jaundice, inadequate nutritional intake, or what somewhat jocularly I like to call lack of breast milk jaundice. The baby could have a genetic variant like Gilbert syndrome. Now, let's talk about acute bilirubin encephalopathy, because that is why we are so attentive to jaundice in the first place. So the early phase of acute bilirubin encephalopathy is, in fact, one that we see in quite a few significantly jaundiced babies. They're lethargic, They may be slightly hypotonic. They don't feed as well. And if you get very fancy and do auditory brainstem responses on those babies, you will actually see that the waveforms and measures maybe change. In the intermediate phase, the lethargy may change to moderate stupor. They may be irritable, and they may be alternately hypo and hypertonic. They may have fever, and their cry is shrill, high-pitched. And the hypertonia may be manifested by backward arching of the neck and the back, so known as opisthotonos and retrocollis. This is a picture I borrowed from my Danish friend, Finn Ebbesen. The advanced phase, they have pronounced retrocollis or opisthotonos, shrill cry, maybe comatose. Sometimes they have seizures. And in this advanced phase, at least historically, these babies often died. And if they survived, they had a central nervous system damage, which was generally thought to be irreversible. So this baby on the left is the first living baby with carnicteris I have seen in my life after more than 30 years of basic neurotoxicology research with bilirubin. I was in Ethiopia a few years ago, and this baby was lying in the NICU. Now, this baby probably died, and if the baby was autopsied, which I'm sure the baby was not in that particular location, the brain would have looked somewhat like the picture on the right, where you have the intensive yellow staining of the basal ganglia, known as Kerneicterus, or it's a German word and means jaundice of the basal ganglia. The chronic form of bilirubin encephalopathy, they develop a severe form of athetoid cerebral palsy. They have auditory dysfunction. They have dental enamel dysplasia. They have paralysis of upward gaze. And less often, they may have intellectual or other handicaps. Now, most of these babies have manifested the signs of acute phase bilirubin encephalopathy, but occasionally, there are babies who have exhibited but few clinical signs of the acute phase. And now, so here's where I have my problem. And I'm trying to get my thingy to play here. We have a problem with our... You know what? I think I'm going to skip it. But you see the image here? It's a video of infants with... here I am. Sorry, here we are. So these are some children who have chronic bilirubin encephalopathy. And as you can see, they have these uncontrollable movements. You see this girl is trying to look up, and she stretches her whole head backwards because she cannot lift her eyes above the horizon. You see this little gal too. She has the same positioning of her head because she cannot okay, now. See if I get lucky. Okay. This one was supposed to move too, but I don't think we're going to waste the time. Okay, this is the culprit. This is the molecule that causes this severe brain damage. It's bilirubin 9-alpha-ZZ. And as you can, if you can imagine the three-dimensional structure, this has the ridge tile structure that I talked about. Now, how does bilirubin get into brain? I'm not going to go into details about all these different mechanisms. But let's say that normally, bilirubin, in its unbound form, can cross from blood and into brain in a small fraction. Now, if you look at lipid-soluble drugs, they would cross much more than bilirubin does, and that is because in the blood-brain barrier, we have transporters that tend to flip bilirubin out again. But if these transporters, phosphoglycoprotein, for instance, are inhibited, that could increase transit into brain. If you open the blood-brain barrier, as you might do in hyperosmolality, for instance, with hyperglycemia, high urea levels, etc., that'll increase the entry into brain. And increased brain blood flow will do the same. So there are many ways that can occur in a sick baby and through which the bilirubin content in brain is going to be increased. And now, whether those acute symptoms are reversible or not, whether that's an all or none mechanism or whether it's a graded thing, we really don't know for sure. Now, what is the mechanism for brain damage in jaundice? Well, as you can see from this cartoon, and once again, I'm not going to go into detail here, there's an army of contenders. In other words, if you chuck bilirubin into some kind of neurological test system, there's almost no limit to how many effects of bilirubin that you will find. And is that specific, or is it, as Tony McDonough claimed many years ago, is that because bilirubin is a so-called promiscuous inhibitor? In other words, are these effects specific, or are they pseudo, and we don't know. So here's our conundrum. Bilirubin, elevated bilirubin is extremely common because all newborns have transient jaundice, although we don't see it with our eyes in all of them. Kernicterus, on the other hand, is extremely rare. Incidence figures vary from 1 in 40,000 to 1 in 150,000 births in the industrialized world, and Norway has been fortunate to have only 1 in 600,000. But in low and middle income countries, kernicterus is still an important cause of cerebral palsy. And the other side of the puzzle is, why do some babies develop kernicterus at moderately elevated bilirubin levels that are well tolerated by others? So is it the brain entry phase? Is it the localization phenomenon? Why does it end up in the basal ganglia? Well, nobody has been able to show why. And is it the impact of being sick, with all that does with your bilirubin binding capacity, the patency of the blood-brain barrier, etc.? There are many puzzles here. So is there, in fact, a basic mechanism? Well, once again, there's been a multitude of inhibitory effects shown in vitro. And is it a dichotomous process, or is it gradual or continuous? To which point is it reversible in clinical care of severely jaundiced infant? That certainly is an important question. So let me just give you a quick review of some of the things that I've been involved in through the years. I've looked at bilirubin uptake, distribution, and excretion in rats. And I've been able to show a good few things about uptake and excretion, but the localization phenomenon I have never been able to copy in animal models, and neither has really anyone else. Neurotransmitter metabolism is largely inhibited by bilirubin. Protein phosphorylation is an very important regulatory mechanism in enzyme function, and bilirubin inhibits a number of neuroproteins. One of the important ones is synapsin 1, which is responsible for neurotransmitter release at the synaptic cleft, and thus you could speculate that inhibited phosphorylation of synapsin 1 is the cause of the drowsiness in jaundice babies. It's certainly possible. I have also studied the bilirubin metabolizing activity in brain, and there is an enzyme on the inner mitochondrial membrane which was first discovered almost 50 years ago. And I'm currently going back and forth between Norway and a lab at Stanford University trying to identify the specific protein. We're close, but we're not quite there. I think it's a cytochrome oxidase for those who are interested. Now, why does phototherapy work? Well, it works because because light converts bilirubin to water-soluble isomers, and they can be excreted in bile and urine without needing conjugation. So here is once again this ridge tile structure seen on the left. And the top illustration is of the ZZ isomer. And Z is for German zusammen, meaning together. It means that the side chains are linked to each other. And because they are so linked, the molecule is essentially insoluble in water. However, light can convert bilirubin either to the ZE isomer seen on the lower left or to lumirubin seen on the right. And both of those are water-soluble because now one or more of the side chains are free and can attach to water molecules. And here is a schematic that you can find in New England Journal of Medicine a few years back where you see the same thing illustrated. So the structural isomer, Z-lumirubin, is notable because that process is irreversible. Once Z-lumirubin is formed, it doesn't revert. It's excreted very rapidly and disappears. The configurational isomers, the ZE or EZ, they can revert back to ZZ, and they are also not quite as rapidly excreted, so that they accumulate in serum, and we can actually measure those, as I will show you later. Now, the photoisomers are more polar, and that's why phototherapy enhances bilirubin excretion in bile and urine. It becomes excretable as water-soluble. So you could ask then, okay, if that is the case, does that matter as far as the ability of bilirubin to cross membranes, specifically crossing the blood-brain barrier to enter brain? The physicochemical characteristics of bilirubin suggest that this conversion may be beneficial. And if after 2 hours of phototherapy, as we have shown, 25% of bilirubin is photoisomerized, it means that only 75% remains able to cross the blood-brain barrier. So we did a study, and I'm going to skip this slide because I think our time is running, but we ended up giving some babies single, some babies double fluorescent phototherapy, and some babies with LED lights. And it doesn't matter really now which are blue, red, and black, because what you can see as far as the formation of photoisomers, it doesn't really make much of a difference. And all of these babies got high-intensity phototherapy. Now, this doesn't mean that double phototherapy does not work more, because what we have been able to measure here is the ZE photoisomer that accumulates. The lumirubin that does not accumulate was not measurable and obviously could have formed more and disappeared more rapidly with the double phototherapy. Now, many studies have been made through many years to look at the toxicity of photoisomers, and in one way or the other, all of them are theoretically or methodologically flawed. So none of the findings are definite. But the basic question really is not whether the photoisomers per se are toxic to neurons in vitro. The most important question is whether the photoisomers get to the brain neurons. In other words, can they cross the blood-brain barrier? And Finnebison and I are currently attempting to design an animal study to see if it is possible at all to test that hypothesis. Intravenous immune globulin, and I'm almost at the end of my talk now, has been reported by some to be of a therapeutic benefit in RH and ABO incompatibility, but others find no effect. So that's an important question. What is true? Now, could there be differences in the quality and specificity of IVIG preps? That's speculative. I'm not saying that couldn't be true, but I know of no studies that have addressed that question. But you need, in those studies that are positive versus negative, to look at experimental design. Some have used IVIG as a rescue, and some have given it to all comers. Now, we studied this some years ago, and in our entry criteria, IVIG was used only as rescue. In other words, it was given only to babies who were on the verge of or had already passed the level of needing an exchange transfusion. And all the others, if they had RH or ABO incompatibility or not, were managed by intensive phototherapy. And our results were significantly in favor of IVIG. In fact, in our level 3 to 4 NICU, where we used to do oodles of these things, we now only do 0 to 2 exchanges per year. So I think that evidence is fairly convincing. Here's an example of how effective intensive phototherapy and IVIG can be. So here is a baby who comes in with a total serum bilirubin of close to 30, 489 micromoles per liter. Get started on IV and intensive phototherapy immediately. And within a few hours, as you can see, the bilirubin is almost half of where it started with IVIG and phototherapy only. And the baby had no sequelae. So if you give IVIG to all babies who have ABO and RH incompatibility, you're wasting most of the med. And those who fail to find an effect, in my opinion, have washed out that effect by giving the drug to babies who really did not need it and thus also did not benefit. Exchange transfusion obviously was the first truly efficacious treatment for jaundice. In my country now, I don't know what your situation is, but in my country, it's becoming a vanishing skill. It's only old guys and retired guys like myself who really know how to do it. And there may be a very few infants who still need it, and probably it's one of those things that need to be centralized. So in summary, bilirubin neurotoxicity continues to be an important global challenge as far as newborn brain health. The majority of researchers have, like myself, been clinicians dabbling in neuroscience. And I say that although my PhD is actually in neurotoxicology. We know, however, that the tools are available to prevent kernicterus, but even so, I think it would be fun if we could understand what happens in the brain and why. So thank you now for listening.
Thank you very much, Prof. Hansen, for an excellent presentation.